I'd like to start, open the policy committee meeting for Tuesday, August 16th, 2016. It's 5:30 in the school administration building. We take the roll. Mr. Coffey?
Ms. Van Twyver is not here. Ms. Zalinski?
Is here.
Mr. Coffin's here. Mr. Farrington?
He's here.
He's here. Also attending, Mr. Fredrickson and Dr. Brown. And that's it.
Okay. We have two short policies on the agenda. One was something that someone gave to me way back during budget season on the eye clinics, and the other was given to me over the past week or so in wake of that hearing we had on the two coaches. But before that, Howard has a brief addition to a policy, BAAA, the school board policies and administrative procedures that we had looked at and changed on May 31st. He received, under the right to know, a number of procedures, and he has them all in PDF. And I think he wanted to amend this so we could put them up on the website, so if you'd like to.
Well, I've received them, some are doc files, some will be sent to me as PDFs. But the change that I wanted to, the amendment I wanted to, how I would like to amend this, it would be the, it says limitations of policy. It would be the paragraph before that, after the first sentence, and so that would mean before the word upon. I would like to just add this one sentence. The administration shall post all procedures on the district website listed by administrative department.
Where are you marking that up?
So it would be here, Mike. If you want to trade with me.
Yeah, that's fine.
Okay.
Can you repeat that? Administration shall post all administrative procedures.
On the district website by administrative department listed. So you're asking.
Listed by administrative department.
So he wants to put it right here?
Yes.
The sentence is, the administration shall post all administrative procedures listed by administrative department on the district website.
You could do it that way. I mean, it's the same meaning. I had it flipped, but.
Okay, where did you say on the district website? I didn't get that part.
Here, let me make a motion and formalize it with this language. Okay, I move that policy BAAA be amended with the following text. And then I'll give a location. The administration shall post all procedures on the district website listed by administrative department. That would constitute the change, and that would go in the first, second, third, fourth paragraph and become the second sentence.
Right before upon notification of these changes.
Exactly.
The board shall review and make recommendations.
It says may review, yes.
Okay. And I'll second that, if you'd like.
Thank you.
Discuss. If you have nothing, you have anything more to say? Mr. Farrington?
So what kind of stuff you looking for?
Everything. All administrative procedures.
I don't think it's practical. I don't think it's realistic.
I think the public has a right to know what the administrative procedures are of the district. Employees are affected by all these things. There's no, to the best of my knowledge, online resource for them. Is there an, maybe I'm wrong, is there an online resource for these administrative procedures?
What are you looking for in particular? Like, I mean, I'm not sure what you're looking for.
So for example, some of the things, Dana from the HR department, one of the, I received 66 different files through my right to know request. And a lot of them are procedural things. How to apply for tuition or tuition reimbursement, or a form to do mileage reimbursement, or those kinds of things. Those are just generalized administrative things that, A, from a knowledge point of view, how would an employee do it? And secondly, it's just, I would think it's easier for you guys to have that there so an employee could download that, have it printed out when they come into the office. So it's things like that.
She had 66 of them?
That's what I received, yeah.
And these are things that aren't already on the website?
To the best of my knowledge, they're not. So if you're telling me they are there, then maybe mine's an unneeded request.
The 66 HR policies are probably not on the website.
Okay.
If you're going through, I'm going to guess, well, our policies are on there, but you're talking about procedures, though, you're not talking
about
policies.
That's right, these are the administrative procedures that have now been identified through the right to know request.
It would be helpful to me to know what she sent, which I don't know now for this discussion. And then I think I'd be better informed to answer the question, are these not on the website, or are they? Because I know, being a newbie to the district, some of the things that I was looking for, mileage forms, are under the for staff column, and you just put in your employee code and they're there.
Okay.
But if you would indulge me, it would be helpful for me to know what you got.
And I appreciate that, and I have no problem with that, and I think that's absolutely reasonable. Part of the right to know request was driven to get information essentially in your hands and Dr. Boucher for the transition, you know, in time for the transition. So you'd have that available to you, knowing what procedures are implemented, that administrative procedures have been developed that actually implement the board policies, because that's the way it's structured. So I'd be happy to share with you everything that I received.
I would really appreciate that. And so,
so at least from the HR thing, there were 4 or 5 emails that Mr. Conrad sent me. So I will forward those to you tonight or tomorrow. Yeah. So you'll have the list that I have. I will point out that contained in that, in those 66 files, is a single file, which actually is an index to the other files. So it's quite well organized. I'm guessing Dana Ms. O'Gara did it, or whoever did it, really structured it, and they even tried to assign it by groupings.
So you're asking for that, all that to be put up on the website? Is that
yes.
what you're asking?
Yes. Now, if there are specific things that they might be obsolete, which I understand that's a possibility, or need to be updated, then I would say let's talk about when those updates occur and how that gets on the site. But I think for these kinds of things, I don't think there's any harm in posting procedures. I mean, we're not giving away, there are no secrets here, really. So we're not giving away financial information. There's no access to any confidential things. I didn't see any of those things being listed as confidential, so.
No, I guess the question is, oh, I'm sorry. I don't know how much you're talking about loading on the website. I don't know what the practicality of it. So I think if it's okay, we can at least go back and.
Yeah, absolutely. Let's have the intent is to have a conversation about that, which we've never had a conversation about. So I have no problem working through this until we can come to an agreement of what is and what isn't, or what shouldn't be, or what needs to be updated, what not necessary. That's fine. We're not. That the request was to get it up there on the website. If you want to take time and evaluate what those things should be, I'll be happy to have that conversation with you, no problem.
Mr. Farrington?
What other departments you considered? I mean, at one point in these conversations, you wanted to know about procedures that are used in the superintendent's office and in the and your administrative assistants. Would that be included under this?
It might. For example, so far, let me just say this. The only electronic files I've received happen to come from the HR department. Everything else I received has been hard copy. I received something, I think, because it's not signed or dated, from the special education department. I received some of their procedural things. I don't know if there's information there. From what I saw, it was really more like a checklist, and it was really an internal document, and I see it that way. It may not, that might be an example of something that might not be listed there publicly, because it, you know, it's a checklist. You've got this, those kinds of things, no. But some of the other things, for example, I have nothing, and I'll be following up with a request about this for your assistance, is I don't have anything about ELL or student special services. That was not given to me in a right to know request. So I'm gonna I have to go through everything, and I have to figure out which departments I have received information about, and then I will be making a follow-on request for the information regarding the departments that I haven't received anything. You know, just to confirm that, in fact, that department doesn't have any administrative procedures. So if there is an administrative procedure, and if it makes sense for the public to know what it is, then I think it should find its way onto the website. So to kind of answer George's question, I think possibly there may be some other, we have to see what they are first. And I've only received them this morning when I picked them up. So the intent with this was to get the conversation going, realizing that some of this information should be on the website. And like I said, I'd be happy to go through the process of, if you want my help deciding what that is, that's fine. If it's strictly, there are your procedures in that they're administrative. You own that content of them. I also received information from the business office, and they sent me a booklet, essentially what looks like a, it was intended as a, I'm guessing as a bound document. It lists the various things that are inside, but it's dated May 2001. So either they haven't, that document is old and probably deserves a review before it goes out. Mm-hmm. But that's just, I think the three departments that I received something from was the business office, HR, and special ed. I don't have any procedures around transportation or ELL. Comes right off the top of my head. And or even, you know, and I'm thinking if there's a direct, and help me out if I'm wrong here, I'm thinking director level constitutes a department. I don't know if that's organizationally correct thinking or not. I mean, administratively, a department head would be responsible for the procedures within it. I mean, I don't know. So I'm viewing the org chart and departmental level responsibility as somebody who would be
they'd be
determining,
running the department,
and determining whatever policies the department would have. I mean, they may have a review process that goes up the chain, but that those directors, I'm guessing, and I don't know, you can help me understand that, would be the ones who are responsible for those procedures. Unless it goes all the way up to the assistant superintendents and the department heads don't have that responsibility.
Mr. Farrington?
Yeah, I would suggest before anything like this goes to the board that there should be a little more detail as regards the kind of scope that we're looking at and what the purpose of all this is, if it's going to be something that can be used, and that this was left out and somebody discovered this policy and wasn't there, that somebody's in violation of the policy. I think that it deserves a lot more explanation of what it is that's really trying to be accomplished before this goes to the board.
I don't necessarily have a problem with that. But I just want to be assured that it will be an ongoing conversation here in the committee until we resolve what that is that goes down.
Well, you can assure that.
I can't assure anything.
I have a comment. If this is available under the right to know, then anybody in the district can ask for this. This is not, you know, non-confidential information. I think that we could have a policy that it goes up and work with the superintendent and her associates to go through them as they put them up. If some need review before they go up, fine. But I think in general, the idea is transparency so the board can overlook those policies, because that's our duty, to make sure they're consistent with, their procedures are consistent with our policies. So if we don't have the transparency, we as a board can't do our duty. And it's this not secret stuff. So perhaps we can gradually get them up as we you know, go through them. But I think as a policy, I think it's a transparency is the only way to go forward.
I guess my only response to that would be that we make general policies, but how the various departments on a day-to-day basis isn't really our purview, and this could be perceived as micromanaging if it was approached in the wrong way. And that's why I say I'd like to have a better understanding of the scope, what we're looking for, the purpose. I mean,
And to that point, I'd welcome the opportunity to sit down and look at what you have been given for an education for me.
Intended for you, by and large, and Mr.
And go through some of the, not just the electronic documents that you got, but some of the other things.
Okay.
That will really help me get an understanding of where you'd like to go with that.
Okay.
So if, again, begging your indulgence, if we put this off for a little bit and we have a chance to sit down and talk about it, that'd be really helpful.
That's fine, too.
And I think your goal was not only to help Dr. Brown, but if you have a replacement or if you stay, whichever way that goes, or the other interim assistant superintendents, we need this out there so we can point to it and say, this is where you'll find all those procedures. It helps us as a board, and it helps the administration. We have all our policies out there. It's just good practice, I think.
Yes, especially there was no intent to change the additional, the third sentence, what would be in that paragraph, where the board says here it may review and recommend changes. There's no intent, there's no intent on my part to say that the board has overview, editorial responsibility to change any policy, any procedure the administration provides. But we can't change it, but we can certainly have the right, as we currently have, to review and recommend changes. But there's no intent to micromanage, as you suggest. I think, thank you, Doris, for the way you said it. It's about transparency. These are public documents. They were obtained through a public right to know request. So the administration, previous administration, determined what those documents were and has given them to us. So
I think there was that problem with that hearing we had with the two coaches. They were talking about procedures that the plan of improvement and other items that we had never as a board seen before because we have no transparency. So here you are in a hearing coming for the first time looking at procedures that it would have been nice to be familiar with. It would have been nice to know all along that such things we could ask as board members. Are these being followed, or is there a break in procedure? I just think it's helpful all around, and I don't want to micromanage. I just want to be more informed going forward, so I'm not surprised by things that I should be overseeing, and I have no clue as to what's going on. So one way or the other, I think this needs to go forward, and I'm happy to work with the administration to do it at whatever pace you need.
So if I might, if I read this correctly, this was reapproved in May of 2016?
Other changes, yeah.
So were there any substantive changes made to this policy and what they were?
That's a good question. We'd have to go back and see what it was. I don't recall.
We could look at the meeting. It would be the 31st when the board probably approved it, and then we could take the prior policy meeting and figure out what changes were made. That's how we remembered which policy to put it into. Mr. Kaufman was wise enough to say, we've already talked through that policy before. So
I remember we touched it.
Yeah, we touched it. So it's just now we've got the information that we've been trying for 3 months to get. We just want to share it with you and with everybody on the board and the public because it is under the right to know. And I think some of the policies I saw with HR, they're very informal, where they're telling you to do something and then give the results to Dot and then give those results to Jim. So clearly we need to go through, or the administration, not the board, needs to go through them and find out what position Dot held or Jim held or some of these other people so we could sort of formalize the language in it. Hopefully that Dot is still around to know what position she had, but they're very interesting. With little I saw.
One of the things we did in one of the other policies that have been updated with the committee structure of the district, which is very helpful, was first pass included the names of the individuals who are on the committee. And then the second pass, we asked Ms. Susing to, is it the person, that person is there, or is it that person's responsibility that was there? So in other words, it's an assistant superintendent that attends that meeting. You know, it's a head teacher of science who attends that meeting. So we didn't need to identify specific people, but we wanted to reflect the role of the person who would be participating. And that's consistent with what Ms. Hoensy is saying. It's not Dot who's doing it, it's one of the administrative secretaries in the HR department is going to do this. So you have a sense of who and where, but not necessarily who the person is.
I don't think that was updated. It was policy CAA, and then there's a website online for that organizational chart. We worked with Ms. Susing, and we got a lot of embellishment of it, so it's a lot more clarity for the new people coming in, and that was supposed to be updated on the website. So that document exists, but the website's not been updated because I was checking this afternoon. So that might be something that we need to
do. Did that policy not get approved by the board and find its way?
I'm not certain. I thought we had decided, I have to go back to the minutes, which I didn't have time, to put it on the website. But there's two places on the website. There's one in policy, and then there's one organizational chart.
Okay.
So it's not clear to me.
It might be in one and not the other.
I didn't see it neither. And I don't know which we agreed. I thought it was the organizational chart, not the policy that was supposed to be updated, but neither has been touched.
Yeah, I thought Mr. Conrad was going to work, I think, with Stacy Hines at some point and update the website. I don't believe it was actually incorporated into a policy. I think that was the decision.
Okay.
Right.
So I think that was just going to be put on the website for everybody's information to be updated. It wasn't done as a policy, so.
Okay. Right. That's what I thought. And maybe she's got it on her desk and it's backlogged and it's coming, so maybe there is no problem. Just something to keep after.
Can I just grab that? So, I'll grab the text.
So, Mr. Coffin, what would you like to do in resolution so we can get on to our next two policies and get out of here by 7:30?
Well, I guess I would move to table this for tonight, so we can bring back at a later time.
Okay, and everybody have a chance to look at what policies you've discovered. Okay. The next would be policy JLCA.
Does that require a second or a vote? I mean,
if you'd like, we could vote. I don't think there'll be any disagreement since it's you're initiating it.
Okay, I'm just trying to be formal in terms of procedure, so it's correctly tabled, so it can come back at a future time. So
then you would make a motion to table. I'll second it.
Oh, so I move to table this.
And I'll second it.
Proposal.
Okay. All those in favor?
Okay, thank you.
Say aye. Opposed.
Two more notes here.
Mr. Farrington?
Oh, I have a vote this. Oh,
you do have a vote.
Okay, sure.
I guess it's 3-0.
I'm thinking I'm an alternate.
Can I ask a question?
Certainly.
I don't want to, I vote not out of place. It's just from a procedural point of view. On something like that, if wouldn't that have to be on the agenda for us to even if we were going to pass it? I mean, I guess it's okay to discuss it. Doesn't it have to be?
Well, technically, if you're going to add something to the agenda, it requires a two-thirds vote, but you got the two-thirds vote, so.
Oh, but you can add that ahead of time. Okay, I just didn't know because it was stuff that, for myself, I probably would have brought another policy, which I won't do tonight. I just didn't know if you could do that, that's all. It's just my question, that's all.
Yeah, you're right. We could have suspended the rules and done that, but we pretty much assumed that we would have had the votes to do that, and so we were a little informal, and Howard, or Mr. Kaufman, just got the right to know information this afternoon that he's been trying to get for 3 months. So he asked that we could, you know, start this conversation.
Gotcha. We also thought we'd have time. So.
Okay.
Right.
All right.
So, this is a policy that
Eye clinics.
It occurred during budget period, and somebody said we could save money because the Lions Club is willing to do free eye exam our clinics at our schools, but according to this policy, they can't come into the schools due to the fact that the district hires an optometrist, and the contract costs the district approximately $2,000 a year. So the Lions also do screenings and then make referrals to local professionals for follow-up care when needed, and all of this would be at no cost to the district. So I was trying to save $2,000 if that was possible. The district wouldn't have to do it, but this would give the district, the administration, the flexibility to decide whether to use the optometrist or go with the free clinics. It would give you more options on how to move forward. So it was something I thought we might want to do. Mr. Farrington.
Do we have confirmation that the Lions Club is willing to commit to do this, and do they do the same caliber or quality of examination as the optometrist?
If you go on the website, they talk about it, and they do it.
What website?
You just search for the Lions Club. They have eye clinics all over. So if we can set up a rapport with a local group, and they're willing to do it, we could forego the optometrist. If we don't develop a relationship, then we stick with what we've got. This just opens up the possibilities. Because I did double check, and they do offer those services.
But I guess my question is it an optometrist that does the examination from the Lions Club?
I'm pretty sure that they're eye professionals. I don't know literally if that's the case or not. I know when I go to get an eye exam, the nurse practitioner of some sort will give me exam, and then it's followed up by the optometrist. So maybe they do a lot of pre-screening and say, all these children are fine, this one is questionable, and those are referred. I'm not certain on how the clinics work. So it might be a two-step process. They might send the optometrist, I don't know which.
So again, I would just suggest we probably should know more about that, and if we feel like it's important for these children to be examined by an optometrist, we should know, in fact, if we think they should be examined by an optometrist, I think we should leave it in the policy.
Do you think that maybe in some of these schools the nurses do the pre-screening and then refer to the optometrist, or do you think every child in the third grade goes to the optometrist?
I don't know.
My guess is from when I was in school, the nurse does a little bit of that 20/20 chart and finds out who's got the blurry vision. Or
all I'm saying is, rather than assume and guess, we should know before we change our policies. That's all I'm saying.
I would think the administration would make sure before they go from one step, one procedure to another, that they would make sure that there was safety that's in place. Mr. Fredrickson, did you have something to add?
I made a couple calls around just to find out what was done. We do screen grade 3 by an optometrist. The biggest concern would be the level of screening that's done. Mm-hmm. If you went away and, you know, from an optometrist, the feeling was that was a critical age. Another thing, apparently when this policy had come up in the past, and I don't know when I checked on it, mm-hmm. there was parents who showed up and felt that the care of the optometrist was critical to the care of the kids. Mm-hmm. So there is, I'm just giving you a little background on it, so there is a little bit of information there. So.
And if I might add, I don't know the answer to this, so if somebody else does, please let me know. As a volunteer, you have to have a criminal records check in order to be in the schools.
Right.
And so would the Lions Club therefore all need to be criminally record checked before they?
I would think so if that was. But see, I would think that this would allow you to contact them and see if we could work with them, see if they could provide the level services that we expect. And if they can, we can partner with them. If they can't, we can continue the way we're going. I don't see the harm in adding that. So maybe they do have the services, as I was told that they do.
Sounds like we need to investigate a little bit more to answer some of those questions.
We could table this if you feel more comfortable. It's fine with me.
When do they do the screening typically?
I don't know. I mean, what if they ask, will the district pay for their criminal records checks?
Back to school. I mean, they do it at the library. They do eye screenings every year there.
Ooh, the Lions Club does?
I think it may be associated.
Could somebody identify this mysterious voice?
The videographer.
For the record.
has covered many of these events, and there's always a screening, visual screening that is sponsored through this, that's approved through the whole committee that does the back to school program. The sponsors and the organizers, I'm not sure if it's an optometrist, but they set up a tent, they da-da-da-da.
Over at the library.
At the library, the back to school.
In the square. It's good to know. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Mr. Farrington,
is there a motion on the table?
No, there's no motion.
Okay. I would suggest that we not put a motion on the table until we find out the specifics of exactly what the Lions Club offers, the degree of service. Is it an optometrist? Can we count on them, the background checks? And we should know rather than, and then once, if we have all that information in hand, then we can make an informed decision about what we want policy to be.
Actually, I would like to have a motion to discuss other aspects of this, which I have some concerns about, which have nothing to do with who does the exam, if it's the Lions Club or the optometrist or the eye people that we currently use. So I would like to have a motion that will enable discussion, because I see some flaws with this that I think should be addressed. If we continue doing it the way we're doing it, or if we look for an alternative provider, I think there's things in here that should be looked at. So I would ask a motion to discuss iClinics, JLCAI.
Usually you move to pass, second it, and then you open it for discussion, and then we could...
You don't really have to have a motion to have a discussion in a small group like this.
Okay, so if it's okay, if you indulge me, if you indulge the chair. So when I looked at this, just looking at the text, all pupils in grade 3 as well as pupils who repeat a grade and pupils recommended by principals, nurses, or teachers shall be periodically provided vision screenings to identify possible vision problems. If screening indicates follow-up care is needed, pupils will be referred for further medical evaluation. Appropriate records will be maintained. Parents shall be notified of the need of further examinations. Well, the questions that I have with this is just where it says repeat a grade. So, first of all, it says all pupils in grade 3. Well, my first question is, what about a student who comes to us in grade 5? We have lots of transfers from all sorts of places. So is this, if they don't enter our system at grade 3, will somebody at a subsequent grade be captured, if you will? In other words, we have a formal process that says, okay, you're in the third grade, we're going to run you, you're going to see an eye doc. But what happens with somebody?
A teacher would recognize perhaps an eye problem and recommend them for testing.
There's three cases, third grade, repeating students, and those recommended by principals, nurses, and teachers. Those are three separate categories.
What I was thinking of when I saw this was, why don't we make it part of the policy that when a student enters the district, we check their eyes? The first grade that we get them, if it's first or second, not necessary, but third grade for the kids that enter through lower grades, and if someone's a transfer, the year they enter our district, we provide this just to capture them. That way, that's just part of our welcoming procedure, if you would. And we don't, there's less of a burden on the teachers, less of a burden on the nurses. And we know that it's covered coming in. So that's one of the thoughts that I had in terms of, what about a transferring student? When would they be, because you could go a month or so in school even, right before something crops up with a teacher, before they think there might be a vision problem.
Well, yeah, the only thing I was just going to offer to that, I'm not sure how that would look implemented, because if you had a kid, I don't know if you did the screenings, I'm just throwing this out, you do them in September, you have a kid coming to the district, October, November, then you're going to have to, whether it's the Lions Club or the optometrist, mm-hmm. you're going to have to somehow get them back to do that screening on the kid. I'm not really sure how that would work out. I mean, you know, I understand the intent of it. I'm just not sure how you would do it. I mean, if you said, yeah, next year when they go through the screenings, you could go ahead and do it. But, you know, so, I mean.
Some of our elementary schools have a really transient segment of the population, and that would be very difficult to administer. I think that, you know, this, if a child's having difficulty, I would think a teacher would be probably the first one that would notice it, and they could make that kind of a referral.
I also think that when you go to the nurse, when you first come, they get all your immunization and medical problems and all that. So there is an intro that each student has with the nurse. I wouldn't be surprised if they don't do a quick eye screen. I'm not familiar with it, but I wouldn't be shocked if that's something that they routinely do for new students as they check them into the system and get all their medical paperwork.
I'm sure they looked through the paperwork to make sure there was a screen done somewhere, and you know they'll check their medical records. But to do an eye screen, they would need the equipment to do that. So,
when they put up a chart, you stand back 20 feet, they can tell how off base you are if you're even in the ballpark. So they could do a very broad screening rather than an intense eye examination to calibrate the problem. I think the screening is more when you say that, yes, there is a problem, the child not seeing 20/20, that line, and then the examination calibrates exactly where the deficit is. That's my understanding of the two different terms.
Yeah, I mean, they do look for problems, you know, when they're coming in. I mean, in terms of, you can understand the issue would be with the transient population, how you'd be able to track that, you know, backtrack that. You'd have to come up with a way to do that. And I mean, if you were you and the using the optometrist to do the screening, or the Lions Club, you somehow have to, you know, be able to coordinate that, be able to make that happen. So I'm not really sure right now how we would be able to do that.
But the way this sounds, the way it works now is somebody has had to been in school for a while, some kind of problem has had to have been observed, and then they just happen to be able to make that date the optometrist is in the school. In other words, if they find somebody in October, November, and the screening, you know, or let's say the screenings occur before Thanksgiving, and then somebody is identified as someone, so they ought to get their vision checked out after Thanksgiving. How long would they wait with this policy before they get a referral? In other words, if you don't capture them when they come in to the grade, let's say during some kind of a screening process, and we're 2 or 3 months into school, and you know they sense that, oh gee, maybe it's the vision, maybe the glasses have a wrong prescription. Maybe he's missing one lens, you know, as a kid who lost it in the playground.
We'd probably contact the parents and ask that they go see an optometrist or recommend that. And, you know, say, hey, you know, there's an issue going on with your child. We recommend that you bring him to the doctor or bring him to the optometrist. That's how we would handle that.
Okay. So if that's the case, then why do... If that works for me, is the teachers, the staff identify a problem, they notify the parents look into it. Why are we doing any screening at all? I mean,
some of the students obviously can't afford the care, so I think we're providing.
But we're providing it to every
auxiliary
student.
Care.
Yeah, right through. Yeah, we're doing an initial screening.
I guess the question would be, when we retain an optometrist, what is the custom been? Do they come in once a year, twice a year? Are they on retainer for whenever it occurs? And what do the Lions Club offer as a comparison? I guess...
That's what they'll look into, yeah.
Right. You can do it either before or after. I mean, I just thought the policy was broad enough to give you that flexibility. But if you want to do the legwork first, it's fine with me.
Sure. Well, just if I may, just further concerns about what we have here, the word periodically. Okay, so, you know, students who repeat a grade or pupils recommended by a member of the staff, I'm paraphrasing, shall be periodically provided screenings. So is that every year? Is that every 2 years? I mean, there's no time limit set on this, so we don't really have a guideline, and we're only following up the kids that we identified a problem with before. Are we able to capture kids that might develop a problem that wasn't flagged earlier?
And again, that's going to be your teachers, people that are working with the kids in the classroom. You're not going to be able, I don't think you're going to be able to craft a policy here that does what you want to do. I mean, there's too much ebb and flow in the student population. There's too many things that go on in the district. I think that unless we have examples of a lot of kids that are stumbling around and having trouble, significant trouble with their vision, I don't think that it needs to be, I don't think you can craft the language that will capture everything you're trying to capture.
Well, part of what I'm trying to do is reduce the exposure to the school district.
What's the exposure?
The word periodically, what if a parent requests an annual eye exam at the expense of the school district?
I don't think that they can do that. We don't have
Well, parents are going to be notified of the need of further examinations. Can a parent request an eye exam?
From a doctor, from an optometrist.
Well, they could ask us, you're doing screenings for these other students. Maybe a teacher identifies somebody and the parent learns that screening, students have been selected for screenings, and they say, I want my kid screened as well. Is that possible? How would you say no to a parent?
I think this language gives the administration the most flexibility. I think what you're suggesting exposes them to a greater liability. It says periodically, they can decide what the periodically, what it comes to. They can figure out what they've been doing and work with that. There's no commitment on the district that they have to do something. You're looking for a broader net, which gives them a broader commitment.
I'm looking for an exclusionary net, actually.
Well,
I mean, I want it both ways.
I think we're giving them the flexibility, and they're going to use their good judgment.
Okay.
Certainly.
I'll be honest with you. You know, teachers are going to be the best. Are going to be the best. Your best source of finding when something's going on.
Yes.
They're going to question. I've been in meetings. You know, when they're questioning a kid that's struggling with learning or attention or everything else. The question, even at the middle school, always pop up. Now, granted, most of the kids have been caught at the middle school level that they have vision issues, but that's always something that's brought up. That and hearing, and you know, we always. As a practice, I'm not going to say there's a written procedure, maybe there is, I don't know, but as a practice, it's good practice to look, make sure that the environment's really conducive for the child before we start looking for any sort of disability or anything like that. And typically, if kids do have a vision issue, it will show up with low test scores and everything else, and that is something that's questioned as a routine. Mm-hmm. So.
Okay.
And it can happen at any stage in the elementary years or later. I mean, there's no set year that children's vision
right.
would
no,
fail.
Right, I understand
so
that. That's what I was asking about before.
It's a difficult
but if a problem develops, you know, mid-year, how would it, so the teacher would say, wait, something's wrong here. Maybe the score's just dropped.
Yeah.
Could be half a dozen reasons. Vision is one of those, that checklist that teachers just use.
So typically the scores wouldn't drop if they're having a vision issue. Typically you'd show poor progress all the way through, unless if you know you had an eye injury, which I assume then would be identified. But typically, if you're talking vision problems and you're talking about reading, that's going to be something that you're not going to show progress with, and that's where the questions would pop up: child's not showing adequate progress, or something along those lines. I'm sure there's an exception to the rule, but I'm saying typically that's how you're going to discover if a child has a vision problem. It won't be mid-year something popped up. So. Would you catch them in kindergarten? Well, no, not necessarily, just because you're trying. Well, you don't know where the learning part is there. But if you saw the progress, if you know, it's one of the things I think when as a school board you were talking, you know, down the road you were talking, there's a goal. Everybody needs to read by the end of third grade. So that's just a critical year, I think, where they start looking at that. And, you know, they start really questioning things if a kid's not making adequate progress. That's why I think the vision screening's helpful, too. So fourth, fifth grade, you start to see some things, and you know, obviously, kids' visions can degrade, or you know, maybe the prescription's off, or what have you, and we do pick up on things like that. So,
okay.
Did you have any further questions?
Other than maybe finding an alternative source and saving us a little bit of money mm-hmm. on the delivery of the service, it yeah. sounds like what's in place is more than adequate. To take care of the kids currently in the system.
Yeah, I mean.
You think there's enough safeguards for the transfers as well as the kids that might
I would say
over
so,
time?
Sure. I mean, if you're going to say a kid walks in on, you know, I don't know, October 1st, and we pick it up on by October 2nd.
Oh, no.
But
no.
We're pretty good at picking it up.
By January.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. No, thanks for, you know, answering the questions and I'm done.
Okay, so we will table this one informally without a vote. Just keep it on our pile of things to get back to.
So the question, okay, just table.
Yes. Now that we've given the administration a lot of homework to do, apologize for that.
You don't mind,
Michael. No, and you know, maybe the service would be better. I mean, let me look at it, and I'll go take a look at it.
That's what I was hoping, that they offered a broader set of services than to just an optometrist who would come in and do an exam and gone. If they do this all over nationwide, they might have a whole routine, and it might be something that would help the district.
Do we have a contact at the Lions Club or anything that, or you can talk to me afterwards? That's
okay.
Fine.
Yes,
thank
I'll
you.
Tell you that information.
Oh, perfect. That'd be great.
Thank you. Contributing.
I'm going to say Ed Leishus.
Oh, Ed Leishus. Okay.
He's on the Cable Television Advisory Board. They meet the first Friday morning of every month.
Okay. I know who Ed is. Okay. That's from yeah.
And you may want to also contact Alderwoman Marianne Malizzi Golger.
Mm-hmm.
She helps organize the back-to-school thing at the library every year.
Okay. Okay.
That's two, that's great, thank you.
You're welcome.
The next and last policy we have is a number, 8216.1, GCQ, dismissal, non-nomination, and removal of teachers. This one, everyone was piling on and giving me sections to add to this first, it's only a one-sentence policy. Relative to dismissals, non-renominations, and removal of teachers shall be in accordance with the New Hampshire state statutes. So we added a section B. Perhaps we could discuss them one at a time before we make any motions. No teacher or employee with a valid district contract shall be dismissed without cause, fully documented in the teacher's file, irrespective of the teacher's tenure status. I think that's in direct response to the hearing we just heard on the two athletic coaches. And does anybody have any comments?
Can I ask who everybody was who was piling on?
Board members. These were not mine. These were added, given to me by different board members.
So being new, I asked the city's attorney for some guidance given these things, and he sent it to us today.
Yeah, I'll give it to him.
And it takes a minute to read, so again, with your indulgence, you might want to take a minute and just read through what Mr. Bolton said about the proposed policies.
Very helpful, very, very helpful. I understand that the teachers and employees is inconsistent, and that should be made consistent. He's very right on that. And cause could be just cause. That would be probably a better terminology. Sexually molesting a child, obviously there's no plan of improvement, if possible, you know, something like that. So these are very good, very, very good suggestions. I made a lot of notes on that.
Just can I ask?
Certainly.
So I think, I'm guessing, and I think I understand a source of several of these things, if not all of them, had to do with the recent hearing we had. I think the coaches' discussion highlighted about a lot of issues about documentation of things in a personnel file. So, and the importance of documenting those things. And part of what I think this is intended to do is to encourage and promote the documentation of problems such that in the case where further employment action is necessary, a case has been documented and available for presentation for future action. I hope I said that without general enough, but in a context, did you understand what I tried to say?
I understood it completely.
Okay, thank you. Sometimes we'll ask for interpretation of what I said to see if I got across. So I believe that is the intent of where these various things are coming from. So I thank Mr. Bolton, the city's attorney, for providing us with direct feedback on each one of these items. I don't think any of us are lawyers, at least not in this lifetime.
So could I ask a couple of information questions? And perhaps Mr. Fredrickson, you could tell me, because you are were in the buildings. What kind of training have the administrators had to document, to investigate, to write a good summary of their findings?
What kind of training?
What kind?
We had some training probably about, I would say last was 5 years ago with, so we have had some with Dana Rogatra on going through and doing an investigation there.
And of the 60 or so administrators I met yesterday, probably a third of them are new in the last 5 years,
I would say a good portion of them, yeah, definitely.
So to your point, I think that there is a need for training, and I think that that doesn't fit tightly under this heading, but as I watched the hearing, it was streamed, I watched it on TV, actually on my computer, I think that now might be a good teachable moment, mm-hmm. and there's an opportunity to have a real case study of what just happened and how we might go about that differently should it happen again. And it's just good practice to understand how to, what is good progressive discipline. When I started, I was given the non-affiliated handbook, which I'm not sure you have, but it's pretty well done. This is the non-union affiliated handbook. And on page 4, there's a really good process. And I'll send this around for the chance to look at it.
I know I've read it in the past. It's been a while since.
And it's well done. And I don't know how often the administrators make it that and talk about it, but that could be a component of some sort of training for them to get. And when I met with the group yesterday, some people are administrators for the very first time. And so, regardless of how good or studious you've been in your graduate work, you don't have real life experience doing it. And so, for those of us who have, I think it's a good teachable moment. So I would recommend, and Mr. Fredrickson has confirmed, that now's an opportunity to do some of that work with the administrative team.
That would be excellent. I mean, I love this. One, a verbal warning. Two, a written warning. Three, suspension without pay. And four, discharge. That we have an incremental approach rather than just boom. out of the dark where we didn't have, this is excellent.
But it also does state if there's a such an instance that you don't go through the steps. I mean, that would justify, right?
Yes, well, as Attorney Bolton says, if there's...
So we have a problem, we see it, and in policy, we try to address it. And then we throw it out to the table, and I think your approach is extremely appropriate. But the question I have is, so we have a teachable moment, and let's say we now will pursue some kind of a training opportunity with the people where it matters. Okay, that's great, and it'll be repeated every period of time, whatever that turns out to be. But what I want to ask you, as it relates coming back to the policy committee, is, and I want you to think about it, I don't expect an immediate answer to this question, is at the point of once this stuff is digested and considered and you have a chance to think it through, what we were trying to accomplish, Mr. Bolton's comments, your suggestion about a teachable moment, let us know if you believe that, you know, and obviously board members came forward and said we want to update a policy to address some of these things. So my question to the administration, Mr. Fredrickson, Dr. Brown, is let us know if you want, need any particular amendments to an existing policy or feel that maybe borrowing the text out of that handbook becomes a procedure that the administration is no longer within the world of the unaffiliated, but across where it could apply, because you do have non-union employees, substitute teachers, the coaches in particular were non-union. So it's interesting that the very fringe are the population that drove this issue to the forefront, where it may have existed fine if we were completely union world, because the documented grievance procedures that exist in those contracts. And in this particular case, what you presented is not for union employees. So there's the union world, those employees covered by a collective bargaining agreement that typically have grievance procedures within that contract that we are governed by. And then you have these other populations which are not. And the thing that brought it forward, like I just said, were coaches who were not teachers. As compared to teachers who might have been coaches, then that might have fell under whatever the union contract would have required.
Were they non-union? Because in the contract, as Mr. Bolton points out, and he says we should do it under negotiations, they do talk about the stipends. They call them the salaries, whether it's salaries or stipends for the individual coaches. So, does anyone know were they union or were they not?
They are not union. I talked with the union president. It's not they negotiate the contracts, but they are not union.
So, are they at will employees going forward?
They will be at will employees going forward.
So, even if they were 5 years or more, they would still be at will forever indeterminately.
Even if you're an at-will employee, though, you are, or should be, afforded some element of due process. You know, it's just basic fairness that you are given an opportunity to tell your side of the story, and then that's weighed against whatever evidence that someone has, and then the decision has to be made. So that's, in my judgment, that's just part of being a good employer, is to make sure that people are given some sort of due process as part of their investigation or decision, and that's part of the training that I think people need to have. They need to know what questions to ask, how to conduct an investigation, how to write it up, and not how to overtax your administrators, because these things can really become very time consuming.
I think it's excellent, it's very necessary, but I also think the board needs to have some assurance that procedures that did exist will be followed. And I know that there was a lot of backlash from constituents about this. I even had an old elderly gentleman come to my house today, and he was outraged by it, and he just felt that when you had a contract, there should be some security. So I think the public also wants to know that there's going to be rules in place going forward, so we don't walk down this path again, so that we can avert that type of public display and treat our employees so that both sides feel that the outcome is better. I think this one was very upsetting to a lot of people.
Understood.
Just a general question. How many administrative supervisors? I would think you're dealing with the leadership, obviously, in each school, the principals, the assistant principals. Are head teachers, are they involved in this kind of thing? Okay, so those people we don't have to worry about.
No, it would be your directors and your principals. And.
So it's essentially directors and above?
Well, yeah, the directors sometimes parallel with the principals, but yeah.
Okay. Yeah. I think of principals as directors of a building. And I don't know if that's fair or not, but, and I don't mean to diminish authority by anybody, but organizationally they lead a team of, you know, 50 to 60, 70, I mean, however many teachers, the staff, the administrators in that school. So
pretty much anybody that has supervisory evaluation responsibilities, right?
And that number is about, help me out.
I have no idea. You'd have to,
100, 150, 200 people?
50. If I had to guess, we probably had, what, 60-something
at
the things.
We had 60 people there,
so
I don't
know, ballpark at 70 houses.
Okay, so that's pretty close to,
yeah, right? Yeah.
Okay, so now you have scope, you have scale.
I don't want you to nail me down on
No, I'm just...
Too late.
No, I think you're wrong about that. No. I mean, that's why I said it the way I did, you know.
I think it's about 60, and I'm not sure all of them have direct supervisory responsibilities. For example, Stacy was there yesterday, Stacy Hines, and she doesn't supervise staff.
Right.
So
okay.
I think it's probably fewer than 60. It's probably between 50 and 60.
Yeah. Okay.
So well, the good news, that's a manageable number.
Yeah.
To deliver that kind of training to.
Okay.
Okay. So that I was going for scope. I'm trying to figure out how many people would we hope to train I think it's a great idea. I love the way the teachable moment using, hey, let's look at our case study, because that brings a lot of issues to home.
And to be honest with you, it's typically done, even as a veteran administrator, I'll typically go through the training, get a refresher, pull the course. So, I mean, it's not a bad idea even without the teachable moment or what we're talking about at this point. So.
Yeah, it's training that I did for superintendents when I worked in Maine, and I always did it with my administrators annually, because we always had turnover.
I was going to say, listening to this, it reminded me of on the ethics, when we were talking about the ethics at the last meeting, that in some of the research I did, one of the districts mentioned that as regards board member ethics, those were handed out each year at the beginning of the school year for all the board members. Maybe a small little handout or something could be put together out of this conversation that could be handed out to our administrators every fall to remind them of this, rather than, you know, and then you can have meetings and all that if you want. But I have another question. A couple of times it's been mentioned, and this is unrelated specifically to that, more to the policy in general. Howard mentioned it once, Doris mentioned it once, that we developed this and other board members participated. I'd like to know how many board members participated were involved in putting this policy together, because as a member of the policy committee or the alternate of the policy committee, I had no idea this was being put together until I came here tonight, or when I looked at the agenda yesterday.
In your packet, yeah.
Yeah.
I had one board member sent me some things that they wanted or mentioned to me, and so I said, well, I sent her back a couple of things. Is this what you're intending? Because she didn't give me language. Yes, and then another board member said, could you add, I heard you're doing something on this topic, could you add a couple, and that she had other things that I hadn't thought about, and I put that in. But
so there were four board members who were involved in putting this together?
Two, as far as I know.
No, I just received what was in the packet. I had no input to this.
Okay.
There were two board members giving me stuff, and I talked to the ones that gave me stuff, is this what you meant?
Okay.
So that was, it really wasn't anything I planned or anything, that it just was spontaneous, people giving me things.
I mean, I had no direct involvement in this at all, except attending the meeting and knowing we need to do something. And not knowing what that would be, I really love the approach you're suggesting.
And Mrs. Ziem said that there would be a procedure going forward to address this. And then she asked if I would be willing to put something forward. I said, certainly. She gave me a few ideas, and I just made sure that the language was what she wanted. And then I had a second board member that asked me, would I add some things or do, you know, make sure I, you know, discuss, because she heard Sandra. She knew that something was going to come forward, and she added a couple of things.
But we have a workable solution now.
But there's no reason why we can't do this, too. I think we can work on both sides unless there's a problem.
The attorney said it is the advice of this department to please note subsection not be adopted as is, but only after detailed analysis of the various situations in which they might be applied.
Well, I think we need to review this and update it. I don't see, he didn't say don't even attempt it. Yeah.
I don't know how much clearer it needs to be. It says don't adopt it.
As is, don't adopt it as is. So maybe we review it with, in light of this, and send him an updated copy and see if he finds that, taking all of his suggestions into account. I mean, I don't think he was telling us don't consider addressing a problem. Just this isn't final legal language. And Mrs. Ziem did ask me to bring this to his attention Thursday. We had a meeting with the attorney, but I had to put in by, you know, prior to that, Thursday morning, I had to give forward what was going to be on this agenda. So that was after the fact by Thursday night. So there really, there wasn't an opportunity in that sense.
So are we, excuse me, go ahead.
Thanks. I'm just, you know, my comment to Dr. Brown and Mr. Fredrickson is maybe a little bit of, I'm thinking that what I think is a possible outcome, I just want to say it that way, is through the process of defining the training, its audience, the union and the non-union side, given the consideration of the grievance procedures that are in place, and now being able to accommodate those that would have that, I'll just call it embedded protection. Is it reasonable to let the administration work their way through it and perhaps recommend, and that's what I was asking for, is there a recommendation at the back end of this process which would result to the tailoring that Mr. Bolton is really asking us to do? And I don't know if that makes any sense or not.
Well, I think it makes eminently good sense, because I think where this may go to where we started, which was in the procedures. This may not become a policy per se, just as the affiliated, this is not a policy, but this, you know, investigation or whatever may end up as a procedure. So people will have availability to it, but it doesn't become a board policy. And as I read Mr. Bolton's memo, he didn't rule out the concepts. He just suggested, as in my interpretation, the vehicle for them was not board policy.
Some of it, he was mentioning that it was already covered under collective bargaining agreements, and his suggestion on some of those things should be addressed through that, through the collective bargaining when you're talking about non-renewals, and some of it's already covered under state law, so you kind of get jammed up when you have statement A, and then there's a couple other statements, and then when you start talking about...
But you just said they were not union, so they wouldn't be covered under collective bargaining.
What's that, sorry?
You said that the two coaches were not union. So if we go in and adjust the union contract, that won't cover what they were doing.
But what I guess I was saying, this is such a broad policy. You're covering different contracts in there. I mean, even some of the statements.
Right.
So again, that be I think it probably would go back to what Mr. Hoffman was saying, that it probably could be handled through procedural type, you know, improvements and training, rather than going through a major policy change at this point to address those. So.
I'm kind of viewing this is the board experienced a gap in the way procedure should have been implemented, and in response to that has highlighted it at policy committee to the point where we're I think, constructively addressing it. And I think if the policy committee can be patient and let these guys dig in, and I hope you do come back with a recommendation, either some board policy that you would ask us to review and implement, or if it turns out to be some kind of an administrative procedural determination that we've got it covered this way, you really don't need, or you might want to, in other words, just kind of put a big envelope around it so we know that the gap's been filled, and that let them drive the bus a little bit. I think we've pushed the issue over the top of the hill so that it's being looked at and it's being addressed. And now I'm very comfortable with the notion of you guys not letting it crash at the bottom of the hill, but giving it a safe and soft landing so it's in the form we need it to be. And well, I think we've both done our work in that process.
I'm not convinced that the other board members that gave me this just want, it's nothing personal against these administrators, they just want some assurances, because we had procedures, not that we could find them in advance, now we're getting that transparency hopefully, but we had procedures that weren't followed, and there's a series of other outstanding problems that are supposedly addressed in these different items where there is a lack of procedural due process and things that need to be remedied. And I think the guidance from the board, along with them working on their side, I think together we can do it constructively. I don't want this to be an attack, but I just want to give this some structure to what the board expects, because I've heard disappointment from several board members over the short time that I've been on the board for several of these issues, and they just want to put them at rest to know that it's out there, we're not going to have this problem reoccurring, and it needs to be reworded and run by the attorney. But I think they need that assurance that we have a better safeguard. Mr. Farrington?
Can I suggest you send a copy of Attorney Bolton's memo to those people you've heard from and let them digest that and see what they think?
Certainly, that would be constructive. Okay. It's a great suggestion.
Yeah, we can either email or you give my hard copy, let us know.
Email's always better.
If you could forward the email, it would be, we could get it.
Unless you put it in the packet, the next packet.
Actually, why don't we send it to all the board members and then everybody will know what's going on.
I think just by bringing up this issue and this proposed text within the policy actually highlights a number of issues. Mm-hmm. And obviously you've got them in front of you and, you know, thought about how they might be addressed in the training.
Sure. Mm-hmm.
I think we're way further along than you think we might be.
Okay.
And I think Mr. Farrington's suggestion in terms of sharing Mr. Bolton's email, which it was too long to read, folks, so you'll have to trust us on that one. And it'll be publicly distributed to the board, so the public will have access to it.
Public record.
Right.
At that point, so, which is a good reason to send it to the full.
Which is fine. And I think we've got the momentum where it needs to be in the right hands.
Well, we're going to table it today anyway. And unless anybody else has anything further, Mr. Farrington?
I move to adjourn so Jimmy can get to his next appointment.
Can I just add for
Oh, I'm
next
sorry.
Time?
Yeah, go I'm ahead. Sorry. Draw.
Is it okay for new business for next time to
Certainly.
Policies? Next time, I'd like to bring up IKF.
IKF.
Graduation requirements, IKF-R.
Do we have this on? We have IKF. Okay,
under Ed 306, it needs to be updated. We're behind the curve on that. So.
Oh, okay. So what is this? What's in 306 that we have to update?
It's going to be the, well, not 306, but an IKF. It deals with the graduation requirements.
Oh.
Okay.
Courses and things like that.
Yeah.
Credits. So,
It's basically around the math requirement, having math for 4 years, even though you only need credits in for three. So I just want to work with the two high school principals, make sure we craft that. It's already listed in the program of studies that we need to do it, but we need to catch the policy up to that.
Okay.
Yes, we had that. It was scheduled for June.
Yep.
It's on our, we have a backlog list.
Yeah.
We had Mrs. Susan because we had so much backlog, running with a backlog list.
I'm trying to hit the ones that are going to impact us for the instruction for the year.
That would be great.
And then the other one is the video and audio recording. I get back today from Attorney, yeah, Attorney Bolton on that, so I'll make sure that's updated to change the wording to update the current changes and.
Okay.
And.
But I thought he looked at that and was okay with it.
We were waiting.
He has subsequent change?
He changed it, yeah.
Okay.
We're okay the way it's written, but it's, we'll talk about it the next meeting.
Okay.
Okay, that's right, thanks.
Okay.
Okay, and then the last one will be student attendance in relationship to JH. Okay.
Well, that'll be.
JH?
Yeah, well, it's in relationship to Ed 306, so it just makes a reference in there as to, need some more wording on that, to attach parents to notify us when kids are.
Okay, there was also a request from Mrs. Eam that we touch on the continuity between the elementary, middle school, and high school in terms of raising the bar to a C minus, and then the fact that we, when we had the I-ready discussion, there was talk that there's no policy in terms of holding students back if they don't go from, they don't have fourth grade skills, they just keep moving. So essentially, you can get someone reading at a third grade level in the ninth grade. And what can we do to address that situation? That was another one that she asked me. And she said, because I had worked with her on this other one, did you get it ready for this meeting? And
so you're talking about the retention policy?
Yeah, retention and how we can work something that's a little bit, has more continuity. If you can mull that over in your head, I haven't even, I said I would work with her on it. I didn't know where to begin and I didn't start.
I'll look up the retention.
And it'll probably be as thorough as this one we did today that needed Mr. Attorney Bolton's suggestions because it was, again, that impromptu, so.
And so for the next meeting, we'll bring back JLCAI, which is the eye clinics, and we'll have more information on that.
If you don't get to it right away, but as you get to it, yes.
All right.
That one, and we had the other suggestion to put things online as we get to that, too.
BAAA?
No, that we didn't have a policy number. Oh, yeah, yes, we did.
BAAA.
That's where it was empowered. Yeah, that's where we had slid it in.
If you can get to that, I guess, in JLCAI to bring those back.
Do you have an extra copy of Mr. Bolton's?
Sure.
This way, Jackie will ask me for it. Thank you.
Okay.
I tried Jackie. I tried. What was that?
Can't be afraid of Jackie.
I'm not afraid of Jackie, but I respect her greatly.
And then possibly the GCO, if we get any update on that. While we're putting it all together, so that will be, I don't know if we're going to get all
well,
of that.
I think that one, I think, is going to take a little bit.
It may take, the eye policy may take a bit, too, so we're all out there on hold. So, entertain a motion to adjourn.
Move to adjourn.
All seconded, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? I guess we're adjourned. The time is 6:48.